I feel like at some point in life, you always become the old person that was that just are like, well, back in my day. But truly, back in my fucking day. It was a beautiful time. Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Two Gay Mads. It's Matt Palmer.
And it's Matt Steele.
And I have to say, I feel like over the years on Two Gay Mads, I have blathered on and on about the year 1997 in pop and R&B music. I have mentioned that it is my favorite year that I've lived through. I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that it was like the first year I was really, really invested in music, but also there was so much great shit happening.
Yeah, that's like the year where you're first really invested in the stuff, like the year where you like find the message boards online. Like that was very much like the 2002 Oscar race for me.
I wasn't quite on a message board. I didn't even know if there were message boards out there.
This was before the internet.
Exactly. But I certainly was invested. I was watching my MTV. I was watching my VH1. You know, I was listening to the songs that were being played underneath scenes on The Real World. And so.
How did your mother feel about all this, the sexual nature of the adult content you were watching?
I was watching it in my room, so I guess she was fine with it. Since this year is the 25th anniversary of 1997.
You said the number.
I'm sorry.
We never say the number, darling.
We have to say, I mean, people can do the math. I thought it would be nice to look back and see what was happening in pop music in 1997. On my way over here, I was listening to a great Spotify playlist that just was going through 1997 and all the shit that was going on. If you had to guess, Matt Steele, what the biggest album of 1997 was, what would you say it was?
Oh, to you?
What do you mean? No, not to me. To Billboard.
Because to you, we all know.
I mean, to me, we all know.
To Billboard? Album?
Yes.
Oh, God.
It's someone we talk about.
Was it the Spice Girls? Was it Spice? Of course it was. They were running the fucking show.
I love that you say it as if you knew just a minute ago
They were like the number one album in America. Is this
they
America?
Were in America.
Because the world, of course, I believe.
Billboard like, 200, that was the number one album at the year end.
Because they're
moment.
Fucking legends and. Yes. Are we going to talk about the Spice Girls?
Well, I mean, I'm sure we will.
Oh, yes,
but let's just talk about what else was going on in music before we go into our big diva releases, which obviously shaped us, made us who we are today, etc. The year starts off pretty amazingly with Tragic Kingdom by No Doubt being number one on the album charts. I'm sure that's a carryover from 1996. That is the album that features Don't Speak, features Spiderwebs, features Sunday Morning, just like their breakthrough record, the reason that we have the Holla Back Girls of 05. So I can't recommend that enough. I feel like on the hip hop side of things, very sadly, Notorious B.I.G. released Life After Death that year, 15 days prior to the release of that album. He was fatally killed, and that was very upsetting. I'll Be Missing You by Puff Daddy, 112, and Faith Evans commemorating his death, sampling that old Police song. But it was like the year of Puff Daddy in hip hop.
Oh, yeah.
He was number one with his, I don't even remember what his band was even called, Puff Daddy and the Family. I don't remember, and the Family being a part of that. There's just so much great, like Lilith Fair-esque music happening at that moment. I was seeing that Meredith Brooks' Bitch came out that year, which listening back to it now, it's like, oh, you were clearly trying to do an Alanis Morissette thing, but I still love it.
It's great.
The top 10 songs of the year were 10, Wannabe by the Spice Girls.
Ace!
9, How Do I Live, Leanne Rimes. I think that was on the Batman Forever soundtrack?
Sounds about
if I didn't make that
it
up.
It was everywhere.
Return of the Mac, Mark Morrison, still gets played at clubs. Don't Let Go Love by En Vogue is such a classic piece of music and very much in keeping with what someone we'll talk about was doing as far as mixing the genres, getting some rock elements in this R&B song. I Believe I Can Fly by Someone was number 6. Number 5, Can't Nobody Hold Me Down, Puff Daddy with Mace. Again, we're talking about Puff Daddy. Unbreak My Heart!
That's
that. The album Secrets was 96, but the single Unbreak My Heart.
The video in the shower.
The video featuring Tyson Beckford looking amazing. Like, what a classic piece of music. Maybe Diane Warren's best.
Taught all of us, never get on a motorcycle, kids.
No! Or you'll die and and the worst part about it is Toni Braxton will be sad about it. I'll Be Missing You, Puff Daddy and Faith Evans, number 3. Number 2, You Were Meant For Me / Foolish Games by Jewel, which I found surprising because I was like, wait, didn't Jewel debut in 95? But apparently she did. Foolish Games was re-recorded for a soundtrack as well. Maybe the Batman Forever soundtrack? Wait, let's see. Yes, Batman and Robin. So the re-recorded version of Foolish Games, I guess, was the second most popular single of that year, gotta say. I just have never liked it. I like all the other singles from that album better. It just, like, I find the melody annoying. It just has always bothered me.
Okay, well, we're here to talk about how
we are. I'm sorry, just you know,
it was a great year.
This is the exception that proves the rule. Foolish Games, garbage. But then the number one song of the year was a bye, Sir. Elton John.
Oh, of course.
Candle
yeah.
in the Wind, 97.
Wait, it wasn't My Heart Will Go On? Like, My Heart Will Go On?
No, part of me is thinking that that really blew up in 98.
Yeah, because Titanic came out, like, end of 97.
Yes.
And it carried over into 98. Okay, that makes sense.
So I think the top 10 is really representative of what was happening, like, overall musically. But for me, I just have to speak from my perspective.
Speak, baby.
R&B music was at a fucking zenith. I feel like the years between 95 and 98 especially were such a great time for R&B leaning pop artists or R&B artists in general. I was seeing Drew Hill on this list. Boyz II Men released a single called Four Seasons of Loneliness, which I think we all need to revisit. It's kind of speed sung and lighter and kind of was the beginning of the end of their like reign as like Hot 100 mainstays. But my God, it is a gorgeous piece of music. They have another song on that album called like Dear Mama, I think, which you know I don't love a mama song, but that one's really lovely.
There's also another great mama song.
What's that?
By someone who is number one in the Billboard Hot 200 of 1997, the best year of music.
28, say you'll be there.
Yes!
I'm glad that it's up there. To become 135, this is what I'm saying. Spice Girls were really, in my head also, Spice came out earlier for some reason. Like in my head, I think of Spice coming out maybe in 96?
No, Spice came out in 96, yeah. That's how
it did, and then 97 is when the songs were really hitting. For whatever reason, the United States version came out January 7th, 1997.
Of Wannabe?
That's what it says. I'm confused by the release of these singles, but this was a time where you had to release a physical single yes. for a song to chart. So maybe that's my confusion. Maybe it was already all over the radio in 96.
Oh, I think it's like it was overseas Wannabe and the Spice Girls were much bigger until like the craze hit America.
Right. It was like when I would see Quit Playing Games With My Heart on the and like everybody Backstreet's Back. And I was like, I feel like 98 was more their heyday in the US, but in the Europe, it's a different story. I feel like I blathered on. There just was so much happening in all different areas of pop at this time. But there are two artists I'd like to highlight. My two favorite artists. I just want to start off by saying, we never gave Janet Jackson enough for Got Till It's Gone when it was originally released. I feel like that is a song that was supposed to be like the That's the Way Love Goes of this album. It was a little off kilter. She created this really beautiful video, which I'd love to watch with you now.
Let's do it.
That I feel like people didn't really respond to because it wasn't her like being sexy and like in a warm light. It was like, no, we're going to Africa. We're talking about apartheid. More historical. It won't feel like it's 1997 and we're partying in our Puff Daddy shining suits. Like that wasn't what she was doing because she was going deeper, darling. And the album, The Velvet Rope, I cannot say enough good things about. I think we have a whole review of it on our Patreon.
We do, yes.
An iconic album episode about it. So if you want to become a patron and watch that, you should. But man alive, when you're talking about an artist finding their depth, finding their soul, this is like, and not that Janet didn't have soul before, but it's like, she was coming off of Design of the Decade, which was her 10 years since Control. She'd put out like Runaway, another great single. Janet era is very sexually liberated, very up-tempo, very like, you know, cool, I'm an adult. But then this album is like, the internet's coming, I can feel it. And I'm depressed. And I wanna sing about it. Every single on this album is great. But Got Till It's Gone.
It's stunning. It's
stunning.
Like, and it's just like, she's just like whispering everything. Mm. You're just like, what, Janet, what? And she's so cool in the video. Let's watch.
Let's watch it. Yes. Yes.
Look at her smile in the
God, she's gorgeous.
Look at her with that clock. Taylor could never.
I know, Midnights could absolutely never.
She was selling clocks before it was cool.
I don't think she was selling that clock. Who shot this video?
Iconic. And that
Iconic.
Beat just dropping. It's such a mood.
The Joni Mitchell sample in this.
Brilliant.
As well.
Her hair, love it.
There's Joni! First shot. I have to look up who directed this video, I apologize. It's just so beautiful.
Yeah. Mm. Can barely hear you. I love it.
But you feel her, darling. That's the point. I just can't believe this underperformed. Like, I just remember it not being on the radio enough when it was out and feeling so personally hurt by it. And I knew, I mean, Together Again was right around the corner, so it all worked out. But we deserved more. Like, this song deserved so much more.
This was the first time you learned as a child life's not fair.
Well, no, that was the year prior when I saw the Grammys. So, 1996, life's not fair. Yes!
That Lil Butler, I love him.
I love him.
It's like so joyful too, but like not in your face. It's like a
yes.
cool joyful.
Yes. Yes.
Yes, rap about Joni Mitchell. Look at that microphone.
I know. I mean, I think it was supposed to be in the 60s or something, maybe 70s. And I think it was apartheid or something. And this was like she wanted it to be like an underground club. Let me figure out again who directed this music video, because it's stunning. Yes, I thought it was you. Mark Romanek.
Mark Romanek.
Talented.
Joni Mitchell Never Lies. Mm,
he also directed the Scream video.
Oh.
And he directed Shake It Off by Taylor Swift.
Oh, damn.
He co-directed Sandcastles from Lemonade.
Huh.
What?
Is he the one that was like, we're putting Jay-Z in the video?
But like, isn't this an artistic statement? Like, why were people not ready for this for her, I guess, is the question. The thing is, looking back now, people love this song. It's, I think, her most played on Spotify at this point. It all worked out.
It's just very low key. It's a very low key.
But so is, that's the way love goes.
That's true.
Yeah.
That is very true.
Why you wanna go and do that, and do that, and do that? I also love a Q-Tip song called Vibrant Thang, which I think came out like a year or two after this. He produced Meteorite with Mariah.
Okay.
Yes.
Was it filmed in South Africa too?
I mean, look. I would imagine yes.
Okay.
No, it was filmed at the Hollywood Palladium.
Okay.
A pre-apartheid celebration based on that African photography.
Okay. I think that's you can totally tell it was like inspired by very specific images.
Absolutely. And the image of her hair in that silhouette is so fucking iconic. Mm. Man, he directed the shit out of this.
Yeah.
And the song, it's like everything is artful and gorgeous and thought out.
It really feels like Beyonce before Beyonce.
Yes!
Like, I feel like this is something Beyonce would look at in her youth and be inspired by.
Absolutely.
Like,
Matt Steele, do you have anything you want us to watch for today?
I guess I do.
Yes, well, here's a remote for you. What is it? I have a guess.
So my experience as a child with pop music was very different. In the 90s and early 2000s, I was all about musical theater, but I did have some Pop Loves Myself.
No.
All of you who have been watching Two Gay Mats know the Spice Girls are my girls. They are my number one pop girls of all time. They were goddamn titans for 2 years. But what a great, phenomenal 2 years it was. And 97 was the peak of their popularity in the United States. It was when we were inundated with Spice Girl.
They were everywhere.
Everything. Like, the kids don't know. Do not know. Spice Girl craze everywhere.
Like, they were the pre-Britney monoculture touchstone for people our age.
1997 was the year they released their second album, Spice World, which is their best album.
97 was?
97 was when Spice World was released.
It came out 1 year after Spice?
Yeah.
That's so weird.
Yeah, they were like, let's go, let's go.
Okay.
And then they were done. So Spice World came out. The lead single off of that was a song that Matt Palmer very much dislikes called Spice Up Your Life. Mm-hmm. It's a classic piece of music. Don't listen to him. I'm not going to make Matt Palmer sit through Spice Up
That's
Your Life.
That's very
Instead,
kind.
I'm going to play Matt Palmer a song that he does very much like and is a song that they had their best music video.
Okay.
And that is a song called Too Much.
Oh! I love this song.
Because it's great.
It's excellent.
Yes.
And I feel like, I mean, I love To Become One as well.
Oh, gorgeous.
But Too Much gets forgotten in the shuffle of Spice Girls singles in a way that is completely unfair.
Especially because the music video they released for Too Much was
stunning.
Budget. And the Spice Girls, if they are gonna do one thing, it is going to be, hi, we have five individual personalities. And Too Much really just reflects that. They are each like a different character on their own set, playing in a character inspired by a different movie that fits their personality so well. It's brilliant.
Which is why, like, once Jerry dropped out, whoever's idea it was to get them wearing matching outfits and, like, to drop the different personalities, it's grotesque. Like, it's grotesque.
And I imagine like maybe like they kind of wanted to do that because they maybe were tired. They would always joke about how they were tired of having to play up those personas and everything. And it's like, but that was what made you guys all stick out so much.
Even if they didn't stick exactly to the personas, them being individuals was the point.
Yes. It's all about individuality and best friends, babe.
And it's not like half individuals like we just met and got thrown together like Fifth Harmony was. Like there was a vision.
And whenever people are like, oh, but like this random girl group, they had such different personalities too. It's like, no, they don't. No, they didn't. Their personality is what?
They don't.
She's hot and she's hot too, and she is just blonde. Like, no, the Spice Girls were such individuals. And
blonde's not a personality.
Exactly.
Hello?
And this music video just reflected that so beautifully. Yes. Oh.
This so is hot. A great video.
Phenomenal.
Yes, for the thing is, everyone needs to upgrade their music videos to 4K.
Completely.
That must.
So Emma was the girl from Poltergeist. Mel B was Mad Max. Jerry's Casablanca. Victoria's Catwoman. And Mel C was like a kung fu like movie.
Why?
Like Jackie Chan.
Did they pick the movies they wanted to do?
Probably. But like immediately you get who is who right away.
When do they? Do they, I mean, I guess I'll have to wait and see, but do they come together as a group at any point in this music video?
Never.
Jesus Christ. Iconic. I hope they were feuding and that's why.
Yes!
It's like the end of the Will and Grace reboot when like Grace and Karen would never be in the same scene.
Iconic.
What a melody. That pre.
They have to show clips of the movie, I guess.
Well, that was a good transition back into it, at least.
There was another edit of the music video that was all this.
It should be all that.
Yeah. I need to know a way to feel to
keep me satisfied. The fact that she went from this to look at me.
Listen! We're remembering the good times.
You're right, I'm sorry. We never give up on those.
Solo. Yes.
Wow.
Look at that. She's gonna point again, I bet.
Doesn't happen often.
Though. Yes, point again. The Victoria choreography. Oh, the gold tooth, iconic.
Ah, I love those pre's, man. Those are my favorite.
Oh. This bridge.
A bridge! Understand. I will say some of the effects don't hold up in 4K. They were the Blackpink of their time with the budget of it all.
Oh my God, yes. This is when they had the money.
They did. I love that.
You know I love it when Mel B goes low.
She sounds great. Initially you're like, is that a vocoder? And it's like, no, she's just going low.
She's just Mel B.
She's got that bass.
In the basement.
I mean.
Yes, explosions. That's what Victoria's vocals do. They make the world explode. My girls.
Classic.
I miss them so much.
A classic piece of music.
A classic piece of music.
We need to discuss. The album of the millennium. The album of all time. Mariah Carey's Zenith creatively. I talk about this every 5 seconds, but I talk about it for a reason. There's so many music videos from this era that are excellent, and many of which she self-funded just because she's like, the label, my ex-husband, not really pushing the singles from this album. We have Honey goes to number one, and My All doesn't come out until like 5 months later in 98. This era could have been much more successful had she not been having such inner turmoil with the label slash her husband, but the album holds up. We've been celebrating its 25th anniversary for a while now. I don't want to go on too much of a tangent, but when you think about music now and the fact that R&B, pop, hip hop collaborations are a dime a dozen, there's already a whole Grammy category about it. Mariah began this trend from going from the girl who sang Hero to the girl who's duetting with Old Dirty Bastard in 2 years. And this is just a build on that in such a beautiful and natural way. Like, there were obviously people that were not happy with it. We're like, oh, why is she dressing like that? Why is she hanging out with these rappers? But sonically, you can't say she didn't sound like she's been there all along. Like, this was clearly the music she loved. She had so much she had to sing about, so much she had to write about. If you haven't read The Meaning of Mariah Carey, it'll explain to you all that was going on in her personal life. But truly, you get it all from the album. I went back and forth on which video I wanted us to all watch together. And Honey is one of her best videos, deserved an MTV award. The roof is gorgeous and stunning and just got upgraded to 4K along with Honey.
Okay.
But I think to get the bit, like the heart of the album, the like reason it's so groundbreaking, I think it's best that we revisit Breakdown.
Oh, you know I love Breakdown because baby, that is Bob Fosse inspired. We're gonna talk about other great things.
I mean, this
about the movie Cabaret.
This was a music video that I recorded on a VHS when I was at the Atlanta Boy Choir, when it was being premiered on MTV Live with Bill Bellamy and Carson Daly. This is pre-TRL. Mariah's just lying there looking gorgeous in a maroon dress, introducing the video for Breakdown, which was one of my favorite songs on the record. The video elevates it, but man, the fact that she took what was a popular, you know, Bone Thugs and Harmony was already a popular group. They had a very specific style of like sing rapping, very much like the Drakes of today. The Crossroads was a big hit for them in like 95, 96. And the fact that she had studied their music and was so familiar with what they did and wrote this entire song without them, but dreaming of them joining her on the track and just, it just sounds so natural for her. Obviously, her speed singing, singing lightly, fitting a lot of words into, you know, one stanza isn't something new for her, but she was able to make it sound like such an homage to them, but not sound like a ripoff of them. And like lyrically, that second verse, like, let's just watch.
Let's just watch and see.
Let's watch, because man, oh man, this is the stuff.
This is 97.
This is 97. Oh!
Yes.
I think this is one of the ones she self-funded.
The like Fish Island, like angle.
Very 97.
Yeah.
I love the big one bang. Like she's Jennifer Aniston in Friends. Oh!
That gold eyeshadow. Well,
she's in Vegas just like I'm going to Vegas tomorrow.
Are you gonna do this in Vegas?
I should. I'll reenact this video shot by shot.
I love the choreography is just wipe the chair, look.
It's Mariah, we're not doing, she's just starting her choreography journey, which, you know, only went so far.
It only went about as long as the Spice Girls lasted. 2 years.
Oh, but also like, not for nothing, gorgeous. Mm. Like, such a beautiful era. Nonchalant about it. And she's teaching you words already, nonchalant.
But you also have to be like, what were those words?
I remember singing this on the fucking fifth grade bus, being like, I know all the words, and I can sing it even faster than Mariah does.
did you understand the words?
I knew what she was saying. There she is.
I can't wait to sit down and watch Cabaret with you, and you'll be like, oh, this is Liza Minnelli. I guess you'll be like, oh, this is the Breakdown video.
And it seems they haven't got a clue. Ooh. Of the pain that rejection is putting you through. You have two choices. Cling to your pride, sing I will survive. Do you lash out and say, how dare you leave this way? Woo! This is art.
That's art in a hot bikini. Hold on, well, bikini top.
As they just slip away. I think that's Method Man that's the magician with her. Jermaine Dupri's on set. Everybody's here. It's a big group hang.
We're doing magic.
Yes.
Look at that, she's floating.
She's on the craps table, looking gorgeous.
Cause she is money, baby.
And again, guys, just so we are understanding, this woman was singing One Sweet Day in her Keds 2 years prior. Mm. Like, this was a shock for people. But I was already such an R&B listener that like, I was just like, yeah, this makes sense.
Yeah.
She sounds great. This is what music sounds like. I have no notes. Oh, look at that.
This fisheye is just...
it was It was the time.
It's like, in 97, we just wanted everyone to just look like they were wrapped around a pole.
Hoping for somebody looks like rain, 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 rain.
Oh. They're like, okay, hit the beat. You can tell they did like a bunch of takes. They're just like, okay, we're gonna hit. Hit with the hip.
Look, Mariah's not a dancer. But she's singing those ad-libs. Oh, yes. She jumps in the bed.
She's so
believe
fun.
The bed spins.
Now she's a cowboy.
Yes. She was like, I want to get my art out there. Even if this isn't going to be a single, the label pushes, more people need to know this song. I have a visual idea for it. Let's make a video.
This is gonna be magic.
And it's magic. She was right. And like, isn't this just what music should sound like? My God, I just implore any of you out there who have not listened to the Butterfly album in full, take a listen. It's just this era in R&B and pop, ladies at least, is very much like we're going a little more introspective, we're getting a little deeper, and Mariah and Janet specifically in 97 released their best records. Madonna's about to release hers in 98.
Oh, we should have a video about 98.
Honestly.
Oh, God.
What else do you have to tell the people about 97?
Another huge group that released a song in 1997. It was actually, they were someone that my brother was a big fan of.
Okay.
And my brother was never into pop music and was very much not into the type of music that these people released.
I'm nervous. What is this?
Mbop by Hanson.
Oh, Lord.
We have to discuss Mbop. And so when Hanson came out, my brother was like, I like this song and would listen to it the entire time. Mm. In my little boy head, I was like, I can't like multiple people at once. That's crazy. I'm a Spice Girls fan. They're the only people I'm allowed to like. Mm. So like all throughout my childhood, I was like, I hate Hanson. But then as I got older, I listened to Mbop and I'm just like, this is fucking great.
Oh, I mean, Mbop is an excellent song.
I don't know what they're doing with their lives now.
Yes.
There's questions.
We have questions,
but guys, let's remember when we were young and innocent.
Just like they were. That one's a child, isn't he? Like, single digits?
I don't know, 10? They were like 6 years, and that's why like I was not into them, because I'm like, they're children.
I mean, JoJo I loved.
Well, I mean, JoJo is like...
JoJo's different.
Was a talent.
She was a true talent.
They were songwriting talents.
Hello?
Well. They wrote this great pop song back in 1997.
Man, there was so much happening in 97.
Everything was, and like in all different genres.
I know.
It's insane.
Well, I haven't seen this video in years. It was all over VH1 though, back in the day.
All I remember about the music videos is like Zach taps the camera a lot. It was, like, it was made with a camcorder.
Which one's Zach? The oldest
one? The little one?
Oh, the little one.
Yeah.
Okay.
I remember when I first saw them, I thought they were all girls.
I mean, they do look like the Full House girls.
They do. They look like Mary Kay and Ashley.
Totally. Yeah, this is fully a camcorder.
Yes.
The verse is great. I feel like the chorus is a little annoying after we've heard it so many times.
Annoyingly great. Or greatly annoying.
But the verse is lovely.
Yes. They repeat the verse for you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
They're the only ones there.
The little one in his little white boy dreads is tough. I will say that.
I don't think they're dreads, I think they're just braids.
Okay, whatever they are, just take them out.
It was so happy.
It just sounds like a Nickelodeon theme song.
Yes, they're so young.
They are children, like true children.
Like that is a 5-year-old on the drums. Yes.
And then Mbop, you're not there.
What does it mean?
Who knows?
More confusion than any Easter eggs Taylor Swift drops.
What was their ballad called after this? It was like...
There was I Will Run to You.
No, let me look it up. It was something about... Was it something with the word weird in it? What was this? Oh, Middle of Nowhere. What was this album called?
Yeah,
there's a song called Weird. I believe that was a single.
Now they're on the moon.
I remember them having a song that I did like at some point more recently.
Like, you could tell they hung a green screen in their garage.
I know.
Rollerblading.
Get them roll. Oh, this is such a time capsule.
Right, everyone rollerblading.
What were children doing in 1997?
The 90s, flowers were very big. So there's like the blooming flower.
Flowers are so out now. Flowers are so out.
Like every girl had like a sunflower dress or something.
I can see that.
Sunflowers were very big. Do,
do, do.
This part's so cheesy. It's great.
Oh, Penny and Me, I liked as well. 2004.
Okay. Look at you, a little.
I mean, I'm remembering just the singles that jump out at me, but Penny and Me, I like.
The baggy jeans with the rollerblades. This was so cool.
It was a time.
And it's kind of cool again now.
That's true.
This baggy jeans and rollerblades.
It all comes back around.
Well, I guess this is where we say goodbye to you guys. But honestly, I do want to watch one more thing.
What?
The thing that came out in 1997.
Okay.
That was a pop cultural touchstone that represents the two gay Matts to a T.
Okay.
And that is.
Is it all that?
No. That is the Brandy Cinderella.
Oh. My God.
Guys, this was for all of us.
This
was for the R&B heads. This was for the musical theater kids. And it was done flawlessly.
Which song are we watching?
We're watching Impossible.
I didn't know. I didn't know.
Although I do love the arrangement of In My Own Little Corner.
I was going to say.
That has just such
get that drum machine in there.
Just enough of an R&B beat where it's like slightly noticeable, but it's not too much where it's like, oh God, what are you doing to this classic song?
Oh.
Like, it was just so well done. It paid such respect to both like Rodgers and Hammerstein's music and the talents of Whitney Houston and Brandy at
Absolutely.
The same time.
Absolutely.
Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant.
Love the Brandy Cinderella. It's the only one.
It's not the only one.
It's the only one.
I was also in it in eighth grade where I played the prince and I was a foot shorter than Cinderella and I sang in her octave. That was also a great one as well.
I've seen the picture. When is this going to be on Spotify?
I don't know. Literally never, because Brandy's label wouldn't allow it.
But it's been so long.
I know. Wow. We need to call Brandy. And
we
like,
do.
Hi, we need this. We need Whitney's perfect vocals in my ears.
Mm.
Yes, zoom in. On the program.
I'm worried they're not gonna show the scene. Oh, good, I'm right there.
Yes.
Classic.
Iconic costume.
What a vocal.
You hear that little beat?
Oh.
Yes. This is when you hear a little beat.
No one should ever sing this song again. Sorry.
It's just amazing. Things are happening. Happening. Things are happening.
Impossible.
Yes, the question?
Impossible.
Yes.
Mm. Impossible.
Act.
Impossible.
Impossible.
Mm.
Impossible.
Is that when Why Are You Down There happens?
It's a rehearsal process.
Why are you down there?
Oh, the way the orchestrations are built here.
Jesus. I love Brandy so much. Ooh. They should fix some of this.
Never.
Some of the effects are a bit dated.
Yes, this.
Oh!
Look at all that glitter.
That's amazing.
They better drive faster. That's far away.
I think they're gonna be okay.
She's in the carriage.
Oh.
Belt together.
Jeez.
Yes.
A perfect era of Whitney Houston.
That was 97, guys.
There was just so much greatness. Like, we're lucky to have lived through it. If you didn't, I feel sorry for you. Because it's never been like that. Like, there have been other good years for pop music, for, you know, musical, but like, you're not getting Brandy Cinderella.
Oh my God.
You're not getting all the different genres firing on
all singers. The equivalent of that be now? I guess.
Of what?
Of like Brandy Cinderella? And Whitney Houston singing for a made for TV movie. I mean, we get like the NBC Live stuff. Who is of that caliber? Who is the Whitney Houston now? Like Beyonce. Beyonce's not doing NBC Live.
Beyonce's not doing NBC Live.
Yeah.
She's not.
No.
So, it's never gonna happen. Just go listen on your Spotify to 1987 Pop Mix and remember the good times. And if you weren't there, just dive into the good times because there's so much gold in that pop culture area, especially musically. I just can't recommend the year 97 enough. Thank you guys so much for watching. Tell us what you think below. What's your favorite memory or pop culture moment from 1997? Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Matt Palmer Music.
And it's Matt Steele.
And I have Two Gay Mats for both of us. We have a podcast that comes out every Monday. It's also called Two Gay Mats, T-W-O. You can find it wherever you listen to podcasts. We have a Patreon. If you go to patreon.com/twogaymats, you can get access to special patron-only exclusives, be a part of the Discord, which is always very fun, and request patron-only videos of your own.
We want to give a shout-out to Montana.
Yes.
To Adam Parnell.
Yes.
To Jeff.
Yes.
To Fabian.
Yes.
And Fernando.
Yes.
And to our newest legendary patron, the iconic, perfect Chris.
Yes, Chris. We love you all so much. And thank you all so much for watching. We'll be back soon with more Two Gay Mats.
Bye.
Bye.